The topic is research trends in bioinformatics. I myself is Usman Vani. I'm an associate professor in CS department at UET. Okay, so the topic is research trends in bioinformatics. Or mera intro yahan pe likha bhi hua hai aur aap search bhi kar sakte hain. So basic introduction is I'm associate professor in CS department at UET, and then I'm handling different research labs at Al-Khwarizmi Institute of Computer Science. So today I'm presenting bioinformatics lab and the work we have been doing in bioinformatics lab from last 7 or 8 years. So how this lab came into existence, and the history is quite old now. It was established in 2010 by a starter grant from HEC, Higher Education Commission of Pakistan. So when the lab started, the idea was to make a national bioinformatics center, which can have data from interdisciplinary and collaborative research needs of the bioinformatics community across Pakistan specifically. And then from generally speaking, we wanted to have some databases dealing with international database of genome sequences and protein sequences. So when it started, the idea was to just sum of databases of genes, sequences and proteins into one place, and then filter out that information to find out which information is useful for maybe other applications of bioinformatics, such as drug discovery, and then finding like phylogenetic analysis and so on. And but with the passage of time, we have some change in the vision of this lab, and now we are focusing on these three things, which are medical imaging, brain data modeling, and genomics. So this talk will be like a quick overview of all these three things which we are doing in our bioinformatics lab here in KIPS. So this was the oldest project, or the starting project, which I just mentioned. It was entitled as Extension and Development of Analysis Node for Bioinformatics. So idea, as I just mentioned, we wanted to have a local biological data bank. This local biological data bank means that we wanted to have a database management system or a data warehouse in Pakistan, which had information of all the biological sequences which are available in Pakistan, and then similarly finding out biological sequences across the globe. So various input parameters were there for this genome sequences, such as author, accession number, sequences, their active and passive parts, such as introns and exons, and similarly their starting point, ending point, and so on. So what happened was, or what our contribution was, because if we see this figure, so we got information or biological data from different web and other sources. Like sources can be websites, biological databases, images, clinical data, and so on. So from those places, what we wrote filters, and then saved this information in some unified format here in this our server. So from this server, we had a cleaning mechanism, pre-processing mechanism, data filtration mechanism, which are shown here. And once these things are available and we have pre-processed data available, then we used annotation services. Like we wrote our own algorithm for annotating that data. Annotating means labeled those data and found out what sequences are of use, what sequences were able to be converted into protein sequences, and what were generating disease like cancer and that sort of things. So this was our contribution in this phase. And then these sequences were provided to the users by IR system, information retrieval system. Like if someone gives a query, he can or she can get the required information. So this was basically the thing. Anyhow, so it was long ago. So fortunately enough, we were able to have two PhD thesis in this area. One was uniform data model for biological data. So why this data model? Because this biological data is of heterogeneous nature. Heterogeneous means that it is not in a single format. As you can see that if I take example of a website, in websites there is huge amount of data and in different formats. Like some data can be in number format, some can be in texture format, some can be in image format, even some data can be in audio format. So there are separate sorts of data. So what we did, we combined an heterogeneous data into a single form by using in this research work. And once this one is done, like this this place, the other thesis was formalization and semantic integration of heterogeneous omics annotations for exploratory searches. So this one was here where we developed our own algorithms to make that data understandable, which is coming here. So this was the very starting point. So later on, we moved our direction for bioinformatics lab in these three areas. So although this complete paradigm is comes under the heading of artificial intelligence, but our focus here is bioinformatics. In bioinformatics, we are focusing on these three things. Number one is brain informatics. I will explain shortly what is brain informatics, then medical imaging and genomics and proteomics. So moving on. Again, we were quite lucky, and because of the good hardworking team, we were able to earn several projects in the area of brain informatics, similarly in medical imaging and others. So I will be giving a brief introduction of what we have been doing until now. So talking about brain informatics, when we talk about brain informatics, actually this brain informatics term coined by literature, which combines using brain data for IT purposes. Like, so what it means that if we use information technology and combine it with brain sciences or neurosciences, then this term is called brain informatics. So first project, which was again funded by HEC under NRPU, National Research Program for Universities. It was in 2016 and then ended in 2018. So we won this project. And the idea for this project was to develop a virtual brain. So it was purely a software project where we had to copy the concepts of brain in a software program. So it's like similar to a modeling technique or simulation technique, which is quite common in computer science. And when we worked on this project, we studied different models for brain. Even we tried electronic model, we tried mechanical model, then we tried different models for computer science. And talking about, if I conclude this one, we showed that this database model or which is called entity relational model, it is quite good when we talk about this brain modeling. Why this entity relational model proved better than other models? What are the other models? So basically, if you know about computer science models, there are different types of data models, such as hierarchical model, network model, like as I mentioned, ER model, data model, then object-oriented paradigm model, and so on. So we have several papers and other contributions available in this domain. But to be conclusive, I think ER model was better as compared to others because it were the components of the brain were taken as entity, and the relationship between those components was taken as relations. So then there was different formalisms and algorithms were available or proposed for the community. Anyhow, so this was a pure software thing, and mostly it was theoretical work, and we were able to develop or produce some good quality papers out of this. Even the student Satwat Bashir, she was lucky enough to get admission in Stanford University for her PhD. So she later moved on towards there. Okay, so moving on. First project was quite theoretical, but the next one was very interesting because from that fund or grant, we were able to write another research proposal that was brain informatic classification and modeling of brain data. Although this name doesn't suggest that it was a very practical project, but the thing was that we were able to make our own BCI device. BCI device is basically brain computer interface, as many of you have already seen that device. A person wears this device on his head, and we are able to control his emotions and other action type of things. So anyhow, so when we won this project, we purchased some state of the art or industry standard devices from Emotive and other providers. And then using those devices, we were able to make or do several experiments. So I will cover this work with a very short video, which can be seen in this video. So as the name suggests, the brain BCI-based wheelchair, it can be used for paralyzed persons. So these are different informations which we are presenting here. So these are the different components which were again manufactured at our own place. Rather than manufacture, it was like combining these things. So this is a working demo of our wheelchair. And we have done experiments with the ONCAP, DISCAP, and then some industry standards, as I just mentioned, from Emotive. So if I want to be quick, let's see. So this is demonstration of navigation, like a person, suppose a paralyzed person using our wheelchair through our controllers. This would be the specific scenario. So then there are different navigation controls like right, left, and then if we be a quick like stop and then forward and so on. So if there is some blockage, then it is able to identify that one also. So this was brainformatic classification and modeling of brain data and the specific demo for wheelchair. Okay, so all things are connected, like first we developed our own brain model, then use that brain model for running different embedded devices like wheelchair. We also worked on like quadcopter, prosthetic end, and so on. So then we moved towards some applications of this brainformatics for children. So when we talk about children, we came to know that ADHD, basically, which is a very common disease across the globe, and specifically in Pakistan also, there are about 2 million children who are having this problem. So this ADHD basically stands for attention deficit hyperactivity detection. So the idea is that boys or basically kids can't focus on some specific activity because of this disease. So our idea was to make their focus better using our own algorithms and then using these BCI devices. So as can be seen here, like what we are doing through these BCI devices, these devices are quite industry standard, and even our own development, we get the data of the person or the child, and then by making him play some game or some perform some activity. So we measure what is the processing of these activities or signals by from here when he's performing some activity, and then in the contribution wise, we were able to classify these sort of information by our computer algorithms. So after that, what we do, we try to give some input to the children, and then again he again plays the game. Some game, and then we see that what is the learning curve by playing these games and how his learning ability is improving by our algorithms. So this was another project. This was again funded by HEC. So again a demo. So it was tested in government schools also. So this is just a demo from a government school. So you can see that the girl is playing with his only mind. Is that we want to measure this attention and focus. Like if a child has a good attention and focus, and then these are the parameters which we are calculating or noting down for different children. Like that was for the girl, and this is the next one. So it was done for quite a huge number of children or kids. So these are the interviews. Basically, so the idea was that children were able to play these games and then describe, like if they play for several times, then what are the improvements done when they play the same game? And then we were able to using our own algorithms, we were able to make classification of those data which are required from the BCI device. Anyhow, so moving on. So this was the first part. These days we are working in using for Braininformatics. Even we are trying to combine it virtual reality environments also. Anyhow, so that is a future work. The second work which we are doing in Bioinformatics lab is about medical imaging and diagnostics. So medical imaging, we have done lot of work in this area. So here I'm just showing maybe 10 to 11 modalities which we are doing. By modality, we say that brain is one modality, then chest X-ray is another modality. Similarly, liver is another modality and so on. So talking about in this medical imaging, we started from many different regions. Like first one is this brain region segmentation. So what is the usefulness of this algorithm? First one was that we were lucky enough to have several research papers in this area written, because it is quite state of the art and many researchers across the globe are working on this one. So what we were able to do, find out 9 regions of brain automatically using our medical imaging techniques. So which is written here, that like we were able to segment out 9 regions, brain regions, including like cerebrus, spinal fluid, white matter, and so on. So these are just some examples. So first, brain segmentation was done. The other contribution where I think we have 7 or 8 impact factor publication, that is brain tumor segmentation. So if someone is trying to work in medical imaging, it is still a very quite hot area to find out tumor region in some specific brain. And one thing was that we were able to, sorry, is there a problem with the audio? If someone can confirm.
Yes, sir, abhi theek
hai. Okay, sorry. Okay, so I just mentioned this brain segmentation part. Now I'm focusing on brain tumor segmentation. So I was just saying that this is a very good area and a hot area of research. And I think we have 7 or 8 impact papers in this area. So the thing is that we were able to identify, number one, a simple tumor. If the presence of a tumor, that is a binary classification. Like in given a very image of a brain, if there is tumor in that brain, this is called only binary classification, presence or absence of a tumor. Then we were able to identify which type of tumor is that one, either it is a malignant or benign. And similarly, like this malignant and benign tumors, there are like hundreds of types of those tumors. So we were able to identify, I think, roughly 14 types of different tumors inside a given specific brain image. So this is again ongoing work. Several papers are available. If someone is interested, he can find out from internet, also from our Google Scholar profile. So moving on to other modalities, we were able to work on a tumor segmentation in liver images. So again, this is a very fully automatic system available. Just give a medical practitioner, he has to just upload the image in our on our webpage, and he can find out if there is some tumor available, tumor in that specific image of the liver. So demos are there. Okay, just a very quick demo of this one. I will be quick because this is just loading and these sort of thing. So basically, when we have to upload the image, and it describes like at what place this tumor is available, like this one. So I will be quick about this. So we have worked on chest X-ray images because it is very interesting, and most of the diseases are from chest X-ray also. So again, several papers available. Papers like starting from first paper, as I remember, was on identification of only rib cages from the given image. So identification of rib cages is important. If so, for example, in accidental images, if at some places rib cages are broken, then using simple chest X-ray, we can find out what is the size of that breakage, and if these rib cages are weak, then what is the basically below, like volume of that rib cage is area and so on. And similarly, using this chest X-ray images, we can identify several diseases, such as, like here we have worked on pneumonia detection. So again, these are some information available, and mostly we are using machine learning and deep learning algorithms. And since deep learning have witnessed a good results and accuracy in recent time, so that is more available these days. Okay, so moving on. We have worked on areas of abdominal organ segmentation also. So abdominal organ segmentation, basically, which are based on our abdomens, and still several diseases are arise because of these things. So here again, we have been working on segmentation of different parts, and then finding out their correct size, like finding out what is the problem with those, if there is some tumor, if some unexpected growth of any organ, those sort of things we have been working on. Similarly, this spine curvature estimation, if there is some breakage of or some swelling or sort of things here, then identify if it is a healthy spine or if there is some problem, then we have wrote algorithms for those things also. If there is some twist, if there is some basically swelling, these sort of things are there. Similarly, in recent time, because this X-ray has seen potential application in COVID-19 also. So again, we were able to find out if this chest X-ray or lungs are affected by the COVID virus. Similarly, so this is another example of that one. So basically what is shown here is that this is a normal image. And if it is COVID-19, its shape will be like this. If it is pneumonia affected, like this. And similarly, bacterial affected this one, and SARS affected this one. So idea is, given a simple chest X-ray image, we are able to find out that which disease is more integral in that specific area, like if it is COVID-19 or pneumonia or whatever, using a single given image. So all this information is available online through our research papers. Some paper is not accepted at the moment, it is still available through archives also. So everything is available online. So interested reader can read from the internet also. Similarly, this one, that one was about classification, if what is the disease, and then this is about segmentation, like which part is more severely affected and which part is less severely affected. So again, this one is about medical imaging. So again, that example. And moving on, we have also worked on other modalities, such as breast cancer identification. In breast cancer, we have identified that if some breast is affected by the is affected by cancer, and if cancer is available, then what is the volume or what is the growth rate of that one, and so on. So we have just shown 10 modalities, 10 work here, because all of these are already published also. But we have also worked on other modalities too. Like we have worked on ultrasound, then we have worked with PET images and so on. So huge number of papers and codes are available in our lab about this medical imaging site. So the third and the final one, which is quite hot these days, is about drug discovery and precision medicine. So how this takes this side, as I mentioned in the start of my talk, that basically this bioinformatics lab was established for dealing with biological sequences at local level. So when we talk about biological sequences at local level, as you just see that COVID is quite a hot area these days. So using the biological sequences information, we wanted to do things which are other people doing in our area. So one thing was about this drug discovery, and the other one is this precision medicine, which is basically looks similar to us. So identification of drug targets for cancer. So the idea is to find out drugs which are which can be used for some specific disease or for some specific cancer. When we talk about these drugs, we see that it is usually based on our genome sequences, and in genome sequences the focus is majorly on exomes. So in exomes, this DNA sequence has different parts like introns and exomes, and then in which there are some specific active parts and some are passive parts. So drugs are usually made for those active parts, which can be converted use. So basically drug is simply a protein which is based on a DNA sequence. So what is our contributions in talking about this complete thing is that we have been making or we have been using computer science algorithms to find out which sequences or which sequences can be cured by diseases and what drugs can be used to cure some specific disease. So this one is off-target binding profiles prediction. Basically what happens is, this one is just a literature. So basically what happens is when we talk about a disease, this is a concept called ligand basically. So ligand is a place where some drug or some protein can bind itself to the sequence and then cure can be done. So what we have, what is given here, this is a tool developed in our own lab. So by using this lab, we can give a sequence and then we can predict which a disease can bind to this sequence and what would be the positive and negative effect. So prediction of effect of drug molecule identification of off targets. So off targets are places where that drug will work and improve or cure the disease. So gene disease prediction. So gene disease prediction means what is our contribution here is that we are studying gene disease association using gene mutation. So gene mutation is because of a deletion or insertion of genes data, which is basically our DNA data, it gets updated. And if there is some problem in that DNA sequence, then a disease comes in the body. So by using this gene disease prediction, we wanted to see which disease is caused by the deletion or updation of a specific genes. So if we are able to find out that this disease is because of that gene sequence, then we can find out cures or drugs for that specific disease. So similarly, this drug targeting of SARS-CoV-2 using deep learning. So again, since because COVID-19 is a very new disease, and there have been several tries for finding out the clinical trials for this drug, but unfortunately, what happens is clinical trials are ongoing, but no satisfactory results are found out until now. Why? Because of insufficient knowledge of this SARS-CoV-19 molecular structure. Anyway, so what we are doing is we are trying to find out or working on drug repurposing, which is shown here. So drug repurposing means that whenever some new disease comes across, what we do, we try to apply the current drugs to that specific disease and then see if that current drugs are able to cure that disease. So that is drug repurposing. And so for that one, our focus is not on biological information. We are using biological information which is available on internet, and we are trying to find out different computer related algorithms, specifically in the area of machine learning, artificial intelligence, deep learning type of thing. So this is basically a target protein which we want to develop using this drug, and then we try to find out interaction between these drugs and proteins. Similarly, when we talk about, this is explanation of the previous one, for normal people, what happens is a drug is either antiviral, natural, bioactive, FDA approved, and so on, Ayurvedic and so on. So what we are trying to do, we are trying to find out what is a drug repurposing using these machine learning algorithms and these sort of things, which is shown here also. So again, talking about genomics and proteomics now. So genomics is basically our DNA sequence in which we have these four symbols, ACTG, and then from this DNA sequence, due to translation process or central dogma process, this DNA sequence is converted into proteins, which is called proteomics also. So what we are doing here, we are working on biological data analysis. This biological data analysis means whenever we have some DNA sequence, there are two things we can do from that one. First one is sequence alignment. Sequence alignment means that we align, which is written here also, that sequence alignment arranges the sequence of DNA, RNA, or protein to identify regions of similarity. So basically, when we do sequence alignment, we can, in any case, I was talking about this biological data analysis. So this biological data analysis, the focus is on two major things. First one is sequence alignment. So sequence alignment is done to find out active and passive parts in a DNA sequence. This active and passive part, I am repeating, might be the second or third time. It is important. Why? Because the active part in a sequence is converted into proteins, which basically are cells or energy cells of our body. And also, the sequence alignment can be done for DNA, RNA, or protein sequence to find out regions of similarity where we can apply our drugs to improve the, like to find out cure of diseases. Similarly, the other thing is we do phylogenetic analysis. It is also called phylodynamics too. So phylogenetic analysis basically tells us about the change in the DNA with the passage of time. It is also called evolutionary relationship between different species and biological entities. Like as we said, that the biggest study about phylogenetic analysis is done for finding out that what are the forefathers of human. Like Darwin theory is quite important in this phylogenetic analysis, where it is said that the forefathers of humans were monkeys and so those sort of things. Anyhow, what are our contributions in these areas? We have developed our web-based tools for this sort of things, like for sequence alignment and phylogenetic analysis. Talking straightly about these things, there are several state-of-the-art algorithms available for sequence alignment and then phylogenetic analysis. For phylogenetics and analysis, we have like neighborhood processing, maximum parsimony, and so on. Similarly, for sequence alignment, there are algorithms for global alignment, local alignment. So we have converted those into running codes and then have put those things on online versions also. Desktop-based applications are also available. So these sort of things are available. So details are, can be shown here also. Like for sequence alignment, we have these FASTA, BLAST, distance measure, global alignment, local alignment, and multi sequence alignment, these sort of things. For phylogenetic analysis, we have these four algorithms: UPGMA, neighbor joining, maximum parsimony, and maximum likelihood estimation. So these algorithms, we have written codes, and those are available to work on some specific data. So similarly, we have worked on this cancer subtypes. In these cancer subtypes, at the moment, we are working on these 33 cancer subtypes for breast cancer also. So this is again some work written we have done. And firstly, we have done single class cancer classification or binary class classification. Binary means the absence or presence of a cancerous cell in a given sequence. And then also worked on multi-class cancer classification. In multi-class means like in a single sequence, if there are multiple classes available, then we can find out that too also through our algorithms. Similarly, for this genome, like this SARS and COVID-19 to COVID-19 sequence, we have done this phylogenetic analysis. So basically, this phylogenetic tree of COVID-19 patients from different regions of the world. So what it is presenting, like, as you know, there are four basic viruses, like SARS, MERS, SARS, and COVID-19. So we are trying to find out, like COVID-19, or the fourth one is basically SARS-BAT also. So in any case, we are trying, or we have done comparison of this COVID virus against these four viruses like SARS, MERS, and so on. And then we have figured out that it has the most similarity against which virus. So these are done through these like phylogenetic type things. And similarly, we were lucky enough to have some sequences from Pakistan, although they were only two or three sequences, and try to find out that this Pakistani COVID virus is similar to which area virus, like it is either from Iran, like maybe from Europe and so on. So our finding was, to be very quick, it was that it is mostly most similar to the virus which was with the persons coming from Europe side rather than Iran or maybe Saudi sort of thing. So these are basically some figures which show that if this is a COVID virus, then what is the similarity with other SARS, MERS, and remaining viruses. So it is called phylogenetic tree. Again, our contribution, we have written codes to generate these sort of phylogenetic and phylodynamics trees. And these are again examples of these things. And finally, we have also worked on this protein-protein interaction things. So protein-protein interaction, why important? Because when these proteins combine together, they become strong and they give us good cells if we talk about body, and similarly they can be used for making medicine. So if this interaction is good, it will generate a good result, and the new produced protein will be very useful for the body. But unfortunately, if this interaction is not good, then it will produce some disease inside the body. So we are working on this protein visualization, and even we are starting our VR setup where we will be giving students and biologists a real picture of how this protein-protein interaction works and what would be the side effects if this protein-protein interaction is not good. So again, our contribution is in the area of computer science, and then we are developing different algorithms. Data is almost taken from the websites which are available on the internet or which are available through research papers, and then we use data using artificial intelligence algorithms to generate our results. So to conclude, this bioinformatics lab, it is alhamdulillah working for the last 10 years. A very good strong team is available which can work on different algorithms of bioinformatics. Their understanding of biological or bioinformatics concept is quite high these days, and alhamdulillah they are a very competitive and good working hand in the area of bioinformatics. So still we are working in these three things: bioinformatics, bioinformatics and drug discovery. Bioinformatics here, I am taking the term as combination or collection of biological data banks which are available across the globe, and then cleaning those data bases or data banks to find out or filter out information which is relevant to some specific area. And then bioinformatics, as I just mentioned, that it is related to information of brain and how it can be used to perform other like activities like neuromorphic gaming, like controlling wheelchair and so on. And finally, drug discovery. It's like focuses on drug discovery and drug repurposing, where different drugs can be find out to cure other diseases. So this is an ongoing work, and we are still working on different other things also in this lab. And our current focus is also on e-learning and like in improving the learning capabilities of our children using this sort of data. So thank you very much. So I have tried to be very quick to give this overview, because the time which we thought was 40 minutes. So now I'm open for the questions also. इसमें एक जेनेरिक यही है कि क्योंकि टाइम कंस्ट्रेंट होता है, तो इस तरह की टॉक्स में ना एक सिंपल सा ही होता है कि हमारी ना वेबसाइट्स अवेलेबल हैं, अगर कोई आउटसाइडर है बंदा जो क्वेश्चन है और अगर उसे साउंड का कोई इशू है बोलते हुए, तो एक जेनेरिक चीज़ ये है यहाँ पे कि ये तकरीबन सारी इंफॉर्मेशन हमारी ऑनलाइन भी मौजूद है, तो अगर कोई इंटरेस्ट है किसी का तो वो हमारे रिसर्च पेपर्स पढ़ सकता है। ये टॉक भी जो है हम अभी रिकॉर्डेड अपनी वेबसाइट पर भी रख देंगे, तो ये इंफॉर्मेशन वहाँ से भी देखी जा सकती है।
अस्सलाम वालेकुम सर, सर मेरा एक क्वेश्चन है आपसे।
जी जी।
जैसे कि कोरोना वायरस के बारे में आपने बताया, इसके अंदर तो सर हम उसके लिए तो हम रियल टाइम पीसीआर टेस्ट करवाते हैं इसको डायग्नोस करने के लिए। आपने जैसे कि बताया कि चेस्ट एक्सरे के थ्रू हम नमूनिया डायग्नोस कर सकते हैं, और लंग्स की इमेजेस दिखाई थी, क्योंकि कोरोना वायरस सबसे पहले अटैक हमारे लंग्स पे ही करता है। तो मेरा मकसद ये है कि वो डायग्नोस तो लेबोरेटरी लैब से ही होगा, डायग्नोस्टिक टेस्ट है जो रियल टाइम पीसीआर टेस्ट है और बेसलाइन टेस्ट है, तो हम इसके थ्रू से कैसे कर सकते हैं?
हां देखिए, ये जो है ना असल में ना तीन किस्म की लैब्स होती हैं व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट बायोइनफॉर्मेटिक्स, तीन लैब्स होती हैं, ठीक है? एक है वेट लैब, ठीक है सर, एक है ड्राई लैब और एक है कंप्यूटर लैब। वेट लैब वो होती है जिसके, जैसे अभी आपने एग्जाम्पल दी है, चुगताई लैब है, जैसे शौकत खानम वगैरह की लैब्स हैं या आगा खान लैब है, ये सारी ना वेट लैब कहलाती हैं, जहां पे आप अपने ना टेस्ट देते हो। मेक सेंस?
जी।
अच्छा, अब ये जो टेस्ट आप करवाते हो अपना और उसका जो रिजल्ट आता है, जो आपके पास प्रिंटेड फॉर्म में आता है जिससे पता चल जाता है कि भाई कोरोना है या नहीं, इसको कहते हैं ड्राई लैब, ठीक हो गया? अच्छा, उसके बाद फिर हमारा काम होता है, जो हम लोग हैं हम बेसिकली हैं कंप्यूटर लैब के लोग। इससे मुराद क्या है कि अब हम लोग ये करते हैं कि अच्छा यार हमारे पास डेटा चीजें आ गई हैं कि अच्छा यार इसने टेस्ट करवाया और इसको कोरोना है या नहीं, और ये जो रिपोर्ट्स बनती हैं इनके ऊपर फिर हम ना आगे प्रिडिक्शन और एआई के एल्गोरिथम्स लगाते हैं, ताकि फिर हम लॉन्ग टर्म में कोई चीज बना सकें कि अच्छा यार अगर दोबारा कोई डिजीज इस तरह की आती है तो क्या होगा। अच्छा, ये तो एक हमारा ना बेसिक मकसद है किसी भी कंप्यूटर लैब का, ये आपको आई होप अंडरस्टैंड हो गया। अब मैं आप वाले आंसर में वापस आता हूँ। अच्छा, दूसरा जैसे अभी हमने बताया कि ये जो डायग्नोसिस तो यही है कि यार आपने बताना है कि आपको कोरोना है या नहीं, और उसका सबसे आसान तरीका, क्योंकि अक्रॉस द वर्ल्ड एक ही स्टैंडर्ड है कि वो पीसीआर लैब करवाएं, जिसमें नेजल का सबसे ज्यादा चलता है कि नाक में आपके डालते हैं और वो कर लेते हैं।
सर बिल्कुल।
अच्छा जी, उसके अलावा लेकिन जैसे जो हमने एग्जांपल्स दिए ना, अब ये क्या होता है कि जब कोरोना होता है तो वो डिफरेंट पार्ट्स को ना अफेक्ट करता है, ठीक है जी? अब अफेक्ट करने से मुराद क्या है कि आपको ये क्लियर होगा कि सबसे ज्यादा वो लोग प्रॉब्लमेटिक रहे हैं जिनके सांस के ऊपर इसने प्रॉब्लम की है, ऐसे
बिल्कुल, शॉर्ट ब्रीथ, बिल्कुल।
हाँ जी, इवन अभी भी आप देखें तो काफी लोगों को कोरोना के सिम्टम्स हैं, लेकिन वो सिम्टम्स क्या हैं कि किसी को बुखार है, गला खराब एंड सो ऑन, तो जिनको सांस का प्रॉब्लम रहा है वो लाम अला लिंक्ड है हमारे लंग्स के साथ ना, तो अब हमारे पास ये जो हमारे एल्गोरिथम्स हैं, जैसे लंग्स की अगर हम बात करें तो वो ये बताते हैं कि जो इफेक्ट है वो कितना स्वेयर है, यानी कि अगर अगर हमारे पास पेपर्स में इमेजेस हैं, मैंने यहाँ पे शायद नहीं डाले हुए, लेकिन जब वो कोविड का वो लोग जो बेचारे फोत हुए सांस की वजह से या लंग्स की वजह से, वो बिल्कुल उसको ना श्रिंकन कर देता है लंग्स को ना आजा को बिल्कुल ही, और वो बिल्कुल ब्लैकिश कलर हो जाता है और उसको श्रिंकन कर देता है, जैसे बहुत ज्यादा सिगरेट नोशी की वजह से भी जो इसकी शेप आपने शायद देखी होगी लंग्स की, उसी तरह से वो ऑर्गन्स को खत्म कर देता है। तो हमारा यही है। अच्छा, आप स्टडी का क्या फायदा होता है? स्टडी का फायदा ये होता है कि इन केस अगर वो लंग्स का हम स्टडी करके देखते हैं कि यार उसकी शेप इस तरह की होगी, तो फिर हम दोबारा ये सोचते हैं कि यार अच्छा इसकी सिमिलरिटी किस और डिजीज के साथ है, तो कौन सी ऐसी डिजीज है या ऐसी ड्रग है जो इस शेप को सही करने में हेल्प हो सकती है। मेरी बात समझ आ रही है आपको?
जी जी सर।
देखिए, आप दो चीजें दोबारा दो चीजें होगी कि ये तो हम नहीं कहेंगे कि यार, क्योंकि अच्छा हो ये भी सकता था कि हम लंग्स के थ्रू बताते कि जी कोरोना है या नहीं, लेकिन क्योंकि इंसानी लाइफ बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट होती है और चीजें वो की जाती हैं जो फॉलो जो यानी के क्या कहते हैं टेस्टेड होती हैं, तो जो लंग्स वाला है वो टेस्टेड तरीका तो नहीं है, यानी कि वो ये नहीं है कि जी आप अपना लंग्स का एक्सरे करवाओ और आप बताओ कि यार आपको पता चल जाए कि ये है या नहीं। उसकी रीजन ये है, PCR करवाने की क्या रीजन है कि 100% गारंटी नहीं है कि किसी को कोरोना अगर है तो उसके लंग्स खराब होंगे। मेक सेंस?
जी सर।
लेकिन उसमें से कुछ ऐसे लोग जरूर होंगे जिनको सांस का मसला है और उनके लंग्स अफेक्टेड है, तो स्टडीज फिर इसलिए की जाती है। और ये जो हमारी जैसे लैब्स भी हैं सारी, जो मैं कंप्यूटर लैब्स कह रहा हूँ, ये होती है R&D लैब्स। R&D का मतलब ही ये होता है कि जरूरी नहीं है कि जो चीज हम अभी कर रहे हैं वो साथ साथ अप्लाई भी होगी।
जी जी।
वो इसलिए की जाती है कि आगे के चल के हम लोग तैयार रहें कि अच्छा कोई चीज होगी तो फिर कैसे हम कवर करेंगे। जैसे मैंने भी एग्जांपल आपको दी है कि अगर आप एक्सरे की या लंग्स की शेप की मदद से जब आपके पास कोई शेप आई है कि यार ये जो है ये लंग्स हैं कोविड के अफेक्टेड है ना, तो उसके कौन सी ड्रग्स होंगी कि इन शेप्स के ऊपर काम करके उसे बेहतर बना सके। तो ये इसका था आंसर मेरे ख्याल में।
जी जी सर, बिल्कुल ऐसा ही है। सर मेरा एक और क्वेश्चन था, जैसे कि हमारे लंग्स के ऊपर जैसे अफेक्ट करता है, जैसे हमारी चेस्ट एक्सरे के ऊपर अफेक्ट करता है नमोनिया के थ्रू से हम उसको डायग्नोस कर सकते हैं। अब इसकी और सिम्टम्स जैसे थी कि आपको टेम्परेचर होता है, टेम्परेचर की आपकी कॉफ काफ वगैरह आपको होती है, आपको फटीक वगैरह महसूस होती है, और इसके अलावा आपकी हार्ट बीट तेज होती है। अगर हम इसके सेंसर के थ्रू से अगर ये वैल्यू डायग्नोस उसकी वैल्यूज को नोट कर लें और ये डाटा सेट हमारे पास आ जाए इसका, और साथ साथ हम उसको भी एनालाइज कर लें पिक्चर्स को, लंग्स की पिक्चर्स को और एक्सरे की पिक्चर्स को, तो फिर हम उसे एक क्लियर बता सकते हैं। क्योंकि अब जाहिर सी बात है किसी को टेम्परेचर होगा तो हो सकता है उसको लंग्स का इशू ना हो। अब कोरोना में तो यही कहा जाता है कि सबसे पहले लंग्स पे ही इफेक्ट करता है आपकी ये
कोरोना वायरस। इसमें भाई ये सेम आप बिल्कुल ठीक कह रहे हैं। फॉर्चुनेटली हमारी एक और लैब है जिसका जो है कंप्यूटर विजन एंड मशीन लर्निंग के नाम से, और मैंने खुद ही कोई मेरे ख्याल लास्ट मंथ एक टॉक दी थी डॉक्टर कोविड के नाम से, डॉक्टर कोविड। तो ये जो अजीम साहब हैं जिन्होंने भी शेयर किया, मैं भी वो वीडियो उसकी भी शेयर कर पाएंगे, उसमें हमने ये बताया था कि एक्सटर्नल जो सेंसर हैं वो कैसे हेल्पफुल हो सकते हैं कोविड में। मैंडेटरी बनाए लोग हैंड शेक ना कर पाए, हॉटस्पॉट डिटेक्शन थी कि एक जगह लोग हाथ लगे, तो फिर हम यहीं पे कंक्लूड करते हैं। और सिंपल ये है कि ये सारी प्रेजेंटेशन भी पड़ी है और हम क्वेश्चन और सजेशंस के लिए भी ओपन है, आप लोग शेयर करें हमें बताएं, इंशाल्लाह ताला हम भी इम्प्रूव करते हैं इन्हीं टॉक्स के थ्रू। ठीक है चलिए, कुछ क्वेश्चन नहीं है तो फिर इसको लीव करते हैं। थैंक यू जी।